Thank you to the organizers. I'm sorry I can't hear your voices very clearly, but Mohammed Maruf asked me to say something. In terms of this event, I think we have to recognize we are in a transitional period where the hegemonic power, the USA, is in decline and challenged by a number of big powers, principally China. I don't think that means there's going to be a transfer from one hegemon to another, because we have this question of multipolarity and the subscribed to by most of the leaders of the BRICS group, for example. But nevertheless, it's a period of conflict where we can expect perhaps an increase in conflict. At the moment, I'm in Syria, for example, and where a number of proxy wars have been carrying on in the Middle East region for some time. Unlike the idea of the Thucydides trap, where the transition period from one hegemon to another is characterized by a war between those two big powers, I think the hybrid wars are taking the place of that type of friction. But the question of multipolarity, I think, is the relevant one that we should address, basically, and the role of China, not necessarily as a hegemon to take over from the US, but what role China might play in this new world of multipolarity and BRICS. I think that's the relevant questions for us to turn our minds to. Thank you. I'll stop there now because I'm not quite sure what others are saying or have planned.
Russia and also Ukraine, or it is only Israel versus Palestine, or China versus Taiwan. But the behind of three of hotspot, there is a huge master plan, which we call it unipolarity. So if we are talking unipolarity here, we can say identity with the hegemon. So if we in perspective of hegemony, yeah, using term from the Gramsci, of course, the subject is United States. But if we are talking a competition, just like in Indonesia, okay, there is a battle between China versus United States. It is issue of economic competition. So in the perspective of economic competition, who will better performance, yeah, in economic performance, that's okay. It's no problem so far. Okay, the leader of economic today is China. There's nothing to talk about very seriously. Now, if we are talking about United States, now in their import bigger than export, I think, yeah. And if you are talking about the visiting Blinken to China, there is a good remark by Minister of Affairs and also Jing. Jing warned the United States, okay, you want to clarify, yeah, you want to cooperate in economic terms, but do not intervene our in internal affairs. Yeah, do not intervene our sovereignty. That's a warning from Jing. And also Mr. Blinken, yeah, even though, yeah, Xing, yeah, already warned to manage not intervene in the affair of China, Blinken makes a very gradual statement, okay? Do not help Russia to fight trade. That's the problem. That's hegemony. In the same time, United States have Israel doing genocide in Gaza. It is paradoxical. It is a double standard. It is in international perspective, it is isolated, legal isolated, and what we call exceptionalist. Okay. If you are talking about again, if you're talking about unipolarity, there's something here is United States. So what's problem with United States actually? First, United States in the history, yeah. If we ask who is United States, it's kind of people or state. We can say the state and people. So we ask them, what is the people of United States? From the perspective of the history, United States people come from was United from the perspective of the way United States people think. Okay. And secondly, from the specific nation of United States. From the perspective of Roman Empire, okay, who is the people of United States inside of the United States nation, specific nation? And second, it is an inheritance of the United Kingdom culture. If you are asked, where is United Kingdom heritage? It comes from Roman Empire. So what is the problem with the Roman Empire? The Roman Empire has a very characteristic empire. Empire is everywhere. Okay, but we are talking here is United States, United Kingdom, and Western Europe. So with Western Europe, Western Europe people, yeah, is their ancestor, United Kingdom. And where is the United Kingdom? The ancestor is Roman Empire. So Roman Empire is very specific. From this perspective here, we call it their hegemony come from Roman Empire, come from the UK. If you are talking, let's say that in modern era, United States mind. What is the state of the mind of United States? All combined of first exceptionalists. They are chosen people of God. Yeah. They are center of the world. So if we are talking about the hegemony of culture addressed by Gramsci, it's very important in Gramsci term. Hegemony of culture is more important than politics and economy. Okay, in the term of Gramsci. So if we are talking about the Indonesia as a subject of hegemony by US or not, it's very easy to say. Do we, our thing is like United States? Do we style of the culture adopted by United States? Do we form of economy like United States? Do we perform of any foreign effect adopt from the United States? Do our Mr. Tibet, okay, first Tibet, adopt United States performance on? If the answer is yes, we are the subject of hegemony. We are the subject of unipolarity. So, how to counter unipolarity here? Yeah. Because not all of Indonesian people, if you're talking Indonesian people, not all of us agree with unipolarity, again the hegemony. They are enjoying, they enjoy the subject of hegemony. They are in the term of establishment of the hegemony. So that's the problem. If we feel that we are not the subject of the hegemony, we are not the victim of the hegemony, so we cannot say anything about hegemony. Because we are not the subject, we are not we are not the object. Yeah. By unipolarity, by the empire, by the victim of United States foreign affair. Okay, that's my point. And also, okay, I'm talking about multipolarity here because months ago I met with the philosopher from all over the world, but 20. From the part of the world, we can say not part of the West. Okay? If we are talking about China today, we are talking about the Professor Wang Yi, the Buddha, Professor Buddha is the director of the Chinese Institute, and also Mr. Alexander Duque. From the Western perspective, Mr. Alexander Duque is a fascist. But if we are we are seriously read for the 7 books of Alexander Duque. We will open what we cannot say today. Because if we say about Soviet Union and Russian Federation of Russia today, it's very different under the government of Putin. Okay, now they are talking about the multipolarity. First, if I ask to the student of Moscow State University, what is the multipolarity? He said that I of Russia. What is the identity of China? So what kind of multipolarity is? Multipolarity is not something that developing ideology like Marxism, developing ideology like a communist. No. Multipolarity is when you feel that you are part of oppressed people. So you are your spirit is flourish. Your heart will flow. Yeah. Ketika Anda merasa tertindas, Anda sudah masuk radar multipolarity. Tapi ketika Anda menindas, ya, Anda masuk di multipolarity. So simple. Simple. So, kemudian pertanyaannya adalah apa yang relevan hari ini kita bicarakan dari tingkat seperti ini? Nah, bagi saya, according to me, ya, the spot to solve the problem of unipolarity is in the Middle East, not in Ukraine, not in the South China. According to me, why? Because I learned from the design, the para menteri perang, yeah, Prancis, how the France and the British design the world today to conquer the world, new world order. They, if they want to conquer the world, they have to conquer the Middle East. Because in the Middle East, if they can conquer the mind, ya, sumber daya alam dan sumber daya manusianya, maka automatically they can control Asia, ya, Middle East, Africa, and Europe. Because the trading come and out from Asia to Africa, ya, to Europe, through the Middle East. So the Middle East is very important, not only the sumber daya alamnya, tapi human resource-nya. So the problem genocide in the Palestine today because of they have a two plan. Firstly, they want to build a Ben Gurion tunnel, and secondly, they want to gas explore. Ya, it's called it, di Gaza itu di utaranya itu ada penemuan gas yang sudah lama ditemukan dan kontraknya itu adalah perusahaan BP, BP perusahaan Inggris. Ya, pada saat perang dunia kedua berakhir, yang disikat cepat itu kan perusahaan-perusahaan British yang sudah menancap di Indonesia. Jadi Prancis dan Inggris itu bukan main lama, dan cara mereka berpikir itu adalah menguasai Timur Tengah sehingga bisa menguasai benua Afrika dan Asia sekaligus dan Eropa. Dan yang menariknya adalah ini soal trade aja. Jadi Belt Initiative Road, ya, Belt dari BRI, ya, Belt Road Initiative, ya, dari Ping ini adalah saingan, ya, karena Netanyahu sudah menyatakan sebelumnya ini bahwa mereka memiliki koridor baru dengan India. Begitu. Nah, persaingannya adalah Cina. Jadi mau nggak mau, ini adalah persaingan gas dan minyak. Ya, karena apa? Karena United States, tahu sendiri kan, 40% of income from budget, ya, APBN-nya Amerika itu dari military spending. Jadi kalau nggak ada perang, nggak ada demand. Jadi perang tuh sih, gitu kan? Kalau nggak ada perang, bagaimana menghidupi anak keluarganya yang bekerja di perusahaan-perusahaan senjata di Amerika? So, war here is a just project. Jadi kalau kita dari perspektif hak asasi manusia, sesuai dengan sila kedua, otomatis kemanusiaan, asasi manusia. Nah, paradoksnya lagi adalah Amerika Serikat selalu menggunakan demokrasi and human rights. Tapi pada saat kasus di Gaza, mereka tidak bisa berbuat apa-apa. Profesor-profesor sekarang juga ditangkap. Jadi persoalannya adalah tiga spot itu adalah itu, dan itu adalah cara kita menyelesaikannya. Kita harus masuk ke wilayah multipolar. Jadi multipolar, buat pantai itu bagian dari multipolar, menurut saya. dan siapapun yang merasa terbebas oleh satu sistem itu bagian dari makhluk. I think my speech is finished. We can continue our discussion. Thank you.
Sebentar, kayaknya 2 menit aja. Tadi soal apa, ya, geopolitik paradox itu sebenarnya poinnya apa? Kita kan jelasnya masih di sini, masih di sini biar.
Oh. Paradoks itu sadar dan tidak, maksudnya ya. Jadi misalnya nih, Amerika menginginkan Cina tidak mengekspor semikonduktor ke Rusia karena itu digunakan sebagai bahan untuk bikin misil macam-macam kan. Semikonduktor itu mana-mana kok pakai semikonduktor dan mesin mesin elektronik yang dibutuhkan tidak hanya di penindustri. Jadi hidup matinya kemenangan perang Rusia menurut Amerika adalah Cina menyebut itu dan Amerika tidak menginginkan itu. Tapi pada saat yang sama dia mereka mendelivery bebas ya ke Israel. IDF itu paradoks kan gitu. Harusnya kan tidak stop pada ganda kan gitu. Nah kira-kira itu maksudnya paradoks.
Terima kasih. Kita lanjut pada materi berikutnya, mungkin tadi agak clear persoalan apa itu hegemonik dan juga geopolitik. Abang, bagaimana Bang dari perspektif Abang sebagai akademisi dan juga akademisi di ranah partai politik? Silakan Bang.
Terima kasih, selamat siang semuanya. Terima kasih untuk undangannya. Berkali. Jadi soal kita bicara dalam bahasa Inggris atau bahasa Indonesia? Bahasa Indonesia. Dua-duanya oke. Okay. Oke, saya akan ganti-gantian bahasa Inggris dan lalu juga bahasa Indonesia. So the world keeps on changing, ya. Yeah? We had periods of multipolarity and then unipolarity. And then now going back to I would say multipolarity. Jadi kita berubah dari dulu waktu zamannya perang dunia pertama dan perang dunia kedua itu bisa kita sebutkan multipolar. Pemain-pemain besarnya banyak dan mereka saling berperang. Itu adalah dunia multipolar yang tidak stabil, ya. Yeah. And then so that's during the periods of pre-World War II, ya. Yeah. It was rather multipolar. And then after the end of World War II, we transitioned to a rather unipolar world with the US and its allies, the Europe, as well as Australia and other Western or Western-oriented countries become the hegemon. And Russia was the USSR. It was a bipolar world after the end of World War II. There was a bipolar world. There was the USSR, the Uni Soviet ada ya. Diimbangi. There was the West and then the USSR. So it's bipolar, two polarities, two strong polarities. Ada dua kutub yang besar. Lalu kemudian it was Indonesia and other leaders. We called ourselves at the time third world countries. Negara dunia ketiga, Presiden Soekarno, lalu kemudian membentuk Asia Afrika. These people decided that we want none of this. We want none of this conflict between, you know, so-called great powers at the expense of the countries that were once their colonies. So there was a strong identity among the countries of Asia and Africa. That we were all colonies, we were absorbed in terms of our resources, manpower, dignity, and all that. And then after the World War II, a lot of these countries became independent or were left to be independent. Jadi setelah Perang Dunia Kedua, kemudian negara-negara bekas jajahan ini dibiarkan merdeka. Ya ada yang dengan pertempuran seperti Indonesia dengan Belanda, tapi banyak yang dibiarkan merdeka dan bahkan difasilitasi kemerdekaan di beberapa negara karena waktu itu udah nggak trendy lagi menjadi penjajah yang agak malu jadi penjajah. Lalu kemudian mereka berantem, they went on a big fight fight over influence, world influence, the West against the USSR, communism, and all these countries, Asian African countries led by Sukarno, led by PM India at that time. We said none of that. Okay, we don't want that. We want a peaceful world. A peaceful world free of hegemon, a peaceful world free of oppression, of colonialism. Okay, we don't want to take your part, we don't want to take your part. Muncullah gerakan non-blok. It was a non-alignment movement. It was a protest against world hegemons. Like, what the hell are you doing? You colonized us, and after that, you fight over each other, and you want us to be part of you, help you? No. Like, let us develop. Let us take our time now to become our true self, independent self, and develop to become a dignified, independent nations. But then afterwards, so it was kind of like a tripolar world, bipolar, but of course there were others, the third world, right? Dunia tiga, yang bukan Amir, yang bukan pro Barat, bukan pro Uni Soviet. Tapi sebenarnya kekuatannya tidak punya kekuatan. Walaupun kemudian membangun perlahan-lahan ya, melalui Ganipu, Penipu, dan lain-lain, menunjukkan bahwa ini negara-negara bekas jajahan, kami tidak kalah, kami juga bisa. Paling tidak, leave us alone, at least leave us alone to develop, to become our dignified countries. Kemudian itu dunia berjalan dengan formasi seperti itu selama beberapa dekade. So it went like that until the end of 1980s. Was the fall of Soviet Union. So Soviet Union had this entangled into different countries. And since the 1990s until the rise of China, it was pretty much a unipolar world. Unipolar world led by the US and its allies, including European countries, including Australia and others. You can see that as the West. It was a unipolar world. And all the others were kind of like, you know, following up to that until China rose, 1990, and then China dropped its cultural revolution. Kemudian di tahun 90-an, China juga mulai meninggalkan populismenya, dan bahkan tahun 2000, China masuk OTT. The World Trade Organization, China joined the World Trade Organization. And you can imagine a huge country with billions of population, rather well-educated, not too well-educated, but okay. And the most important was that they are disciplined. And when you are trying to build industrialization, first and foremost, you need discipline. Education is easy. You teach someone for a few months, they can handle machines. But discipline is hard to build. Nah, China ini kemudian punya modal. Mereka itu punya populasi yang besar dan disiplin. Dengan itu, mereka bisa memasuki era industrialisasi. Masuk ke dalam WTO, tiba-tiba ada miliaran orang yang masuk ke dalam pasar tenaga kerja. Tiba-tiba, then China become the factory of the world. Within just a couple of decades, China grew. And for China, they have always seen it. It is not a rise of China, but it is a comeback of China. China was once the dominant culture in the world many centuries ago. Before the West experienced their renaissance and industrialization, even before Islam, China was a cultural center of the world. They call themselves the country in the center. Now, so bagi orang China, setelah China kembali masuk ke industrialisasi, itu adalah the return of China. Dan sekarang China, setelah beberapa dekade industrialisasi, China kemudian sudah mendekat ke Amerika dari segi ekonominya. Dan ternyata bukan hanya dari segi ekonomi, dari segi politik, dari segi militer juga mulai mendekatkan Amerika. Nah ini yang kalau disebutnya sering disebut oleh Profesor Kishore Mahbubani dari Singapura, is when the world's top power is in the process of being overtaken by a rising power, then the top power will try to push it down. And that has happened for at least 4,000 years in the history of the world. Jadi setiap kali ada kekuatan besar, dan itu terjadi di level manapun, baik di level dunia maupun di level lokal, setiap kali ada raja yang orang kuatnya di lokal, kemudian ada penantang, ada orang nomor dua lagi naik nih. Nah, yang orang nomor satu pasti diusungkan. Itu jangan macam-macam. Gue bosnya nih, gue pemimpinnya. Inilah yang sekarang sedang terjadi dengan China dan Amerika. China is rising close to overtaking the US. Some may even say in terms of purchasing power parity, China has already overtaken, but it's debatable, but it's in the process of overtaking the US. Still over here, almost overtaking the US as we see now, and this is just a repetition of 4,000 years of history. Apa yang dilakukan Amerika sekarang adalah apa yang telah dilakukan oleh semua great power di dunia selama 4,000 tahun. Tiap kali dia naik pasti diterima. Dan itu terlihat sekarang berbagai sanksi yang diberikan oleh Amerika, various kind of sanctions given by the US. Now the latest one we see is TikTok. The US is asking that ByteDance have to sell TikTok to a US company. To a US company. Like, what's going on? Like, the world's most powerful democracy, right? But it's a national interest. For the US, it's a national interest. Which, of course, I mean, like, everyone can understand. Okay, every country has a right to defend their national interest. So what is happening, what the US is doing, a lot of countries can understand and can relate to that, although it's not very democratic, perhaps. Yeah. And so it's a negotiation that the US is doing to itself. It's not very democratic, but it's our national interest. And we see all of this dance between the US and China. Because the US as the primary hegemon now is trying to push down. Very normal, not just the US. All countries that were in that position for 4,000 years have done that. Now, the issue now for us, of course, for all the other countries, is that where do we stand? Right? Do we want to pick sides? Should we again declare a non-alignment movement? I mean, for the sake of other countries that are not involved in this hegemonic contestation or competition, like, we don't really care. We want to be friends with the US. We want to be friends with China. We want to be friends with Russia. We want to be friends with the EU, we want to be friends with Australia. Like, why are you fighting? We are open. And that's what we keep to be doing. ASEAN is one of the world's strong power that is not exerting its power. ASEAN has more than 500 million population, close to the population of the EU. It's very stable. We have it's among the most stable regions in the world, even though it's very diverse. And for us, untuk kita ya, negara-negara yang tidak terlibat dalam kompetisi hegemoni itu, kita punya urusan-urusan lain yang lebih penting, ya. Urusan-urusan, masih banyak loh orang miskin, masih banyak loh orang yang nggak punya pekerjaan, masih banyak orang yang nggak bisa beli beras karena harga naik, kayak gitu. Masih banyak orang yang belum memiliki pendidikan yang cukup. Itu fokus kita, itu yang sedang kita laksanakan. Itu yang dalam bahasanya pemerintah sekarang, masuk juga dari Golkar, sebagai pendukung pemerintah sekarang, dan pendukung pemerintah Prabowo Gibran ke depan, tentunya adalah mencapai Indonesia maju. Apa itu Indonesia maju? Ya, menjadi negara maju sebelum tahun 2045. Dan kalau kita mau jadi negara maju sebelum 2045 itu, kita nggak punya waktu ngurusin perang, ngabis-ngabisin energi, ngabis-ngabisin effort, mending uangnya dipakai untuk memastikan semua anak di Indonesia gizinya tercukupi sehingga bisa mendapatkan pendidikan yang baik, infrastruktur berjalan dengan baik sehingga antara daerah pedesaan yang kecil dengan pusat-pusat ekonomi di perkotaan bisa nyambung, hilirisasi agar berbagai kekayaan alam yang kita punya itu nggak cuma dinikmati oleh segelintir orang ketika dia diekspor mentah-mentah, itu kan hanya memerlukan kegiatan pengerukan dan ekspor. Itu kan tidak padat karya, tapi padat teknologi, padat mesin. Ketika hilirisasi, itu menjadi padat karya. Banyak orang mengolah, itu keluar padat karya. It will create jobs, akan menciptakan pekerjaan. Kita fokus ke sana. Jadi, from our point of view, for Indonesians and for other people in other countries in the world, we would rather focus more on development, focus more on making our people more dignified through education, through healthcare, through better infrastructure, and as much as possible. Let's tell them to stop this nonsense, to stop this hegemonic fighting. Let's work together. There's a lot of things that we can do together in the world. Mungkin segitu dulu aja ya dari saya, dan kita teruskan bisnis. Terima kasih.
Ya, terima kasih, Imam. Sebenarnya saya ada pertanyaan, tapi nanti kita di bawah sesi diskusi ya. Saya langsung ke Mr. Domingos, Secretary of General Prima Party. So, Mr. Domingos, silakan. Let's talk about geopolitik dynamic.
Baik, terima kasih. Mungkin saya pakai bahasa Indonesia dulu, nanti di ujung baru sedikit saja pakai beberapa kesimpulan. Itu gitu ya. So, Jim, please allow me to present in bahasa Indonesia, and then at the end of my presentation, I will address points by points of my presentation to you. Jadi tadi mungkin saya menambahkan saja karena pengantarnya tadi dari Pak Ruh maupun dari Tuan Beli sudah cukup panjang tentang sejarah dari hegemoni ini dan kemudian bagaimana kita bisa mencapai ke titik ini. Ya, jadi sedikit yang mungkin saya coba garis bawahi adalah bahwa dalam periode unipolar ketika Amerika Serikat memastikan keunggulan atau kejayaan yang di tahun 90 awal saat Uni Soviet Rule itu, seorang filosof Amerika yang namanya Francis Fukuyama, dia mendeklarasikan bahwa liberalisme merupakan tahap terakhir, tahap tertinggi dari sejarah. Setelah liberalisme ini tidak ada lagi. Jadi dia berusaha mengkonter pandangan Marxis yang mengatakan bahwa setelah kapitalisme ini akan ada sosialisme. Nah, tapi Francis Fukuyama ini belum, tidak ada lagi itu. Yang lain-lain, isme-isme yang lain itu. Sudah, liberalisme ini sudah final. Sudah di puncaknya, sudah tidak ada lagi yang digantikan. Nah, ternyata di tahun beberapa tahun yang lalu, Francis Fukuyama harus mengkoreksi pendapatnya sendiri. Dia harus mengkoreksi pendapatnya sendiri. Dia mengatakan bahwa hegemoni Amerika sudah berada di ujung. Dan titik balik hegemoni Amerika Serikat itu adalah terjadi pada tahun 2007-2008 ketika terjadi krisis financial supply of goods di Amerika Serikat. Dan itu adalah titik mulai menurun. Pada saat itu pula terjadi konsolidasi China dan atau Tiongkok dan Rusia yang mendeklarasikan untuk tidak lagi berdagang menggunakan dolar Amerika Serikat. Jadi poin mulai terjadi de-dolarisasi di situ. China dan Rusia sepakat kita dagang kita nggak pakai lagi dolar, kita pakai rubel dan yuan. Kemudian diikuti oleh negara-negara di Amerika Latin yang waktu itu masih banyak pemimpin kirinya, ada Chavez, ada Lula, ada Evo Morales dan lain-lain. Mereka membuat satu kesepakatan juga, kita berdagang tidak pakai lagi dolar. Jadi proses de-dolarisasi terjadi di titik itu. Makanya sejak tahun 2001 ke 2023 itu penyimpanan mata uang dalam bentuk dolar Amerika Serikat terjadi penurunan drastis dari 73% ke 58%. Jadi ada penurunan drastis orang menyimpan uang dalam mata uang dolar Amerika Serikat itu sudah mulai menurun. Ini yang disebut dengan dedolarisasi. Dan dedolarisasi ini ternyata sangat penting karena Amerika selama ini dia mengatasi masalah defisit keuangannya dengan mencetak uang saja. Dan itu banyak dipakai oleh semua negara di dunia. Ketika mereka butuh uang, mereka akan membeli dolar itu. Jadi bisa dikatakan defisit pembiayaan belanja Amerika Serikat itu dibiayai oleh negara-negara yang masih menggunakan dolar itu. Jadi ini problem yang apa namanya yang sangat jelas menunjukkan bahwa hegemoni itu ya, sedang mengalami penurunan. Hegemoni ini memang punya beberapa aspek penting atau tiang tonggak penting menurut pandangan saya. Ada beberapa pilar penting. Yang pertama dari segi ekonomi, yang kedua dari segi militer, dan yang ketiga dari segi budaya. Kalau kalau apa namanya bagaimana menciptakan mindset bahwa dia unggul kita di bawahnya. Seperti main bola kalau lawan Korea, mindsetnya kalau dia lebih unggul pasti kemarin dia sempat menang tuh. Karena mindsetnya kita sama setara akhirnya bisa gitu ngalahin Korea. Dan makanya itu masalah mindset juga. Nah ini itu di yang coba diciptakan dalam mindset hegemoni ini adalah bahwa di Amerika ini memang unggul segala-galanya. Dari segi ekonomi dia unggul, dari segi militer dia unggul, dari segi budaya dia pun unggul. Keberaniannya itu luar biasa, heroiknya dalam perang-perang yang diciptakan lewat film-film Hollywood itu mereka sangat hebat gitu. Dan kita bangsa-bangsa yang lain ini biasa-biasa saja. Nah ini hegemoni yang dibangun. Nah kita berada pada fase itu semua itu mulai mengalami penurunan baik secara ekonomi ketika tadi sudah disinggung oleh Bang Muli maupun oleh Bang Faruk bahwa China sudah meningkat kemudian juga Amerika mengalami penurunan dan di sini bisa saya tambahkan bahwa kenaikan daripada China atau Tiongkok sekarang itu lebih pada industrinya karena bisa dilihat 35% dari output produktivitas manufaktur dunia itu sekarang dari China. 35% produk manufaktur dunia itu China. China sendiri menghasilkan 35% produk manufaktur seluruh dunia. Jadi bisa dibilang dia sudah melesat sangat tinggi kalau dari segi produktivitas industrinya. Ini kalau bicara PDB itu kan gabungan semuanya, baik barang maupun jasa, manufaktur maupun non-manufaktur. Nah kalau ditambah manufaktur, misalnya keuangan, asuransi dan lain-lain, nah itu memang Amerika masih di atas, walaupun trennya Amerika menurun, ternyata meningkat gitu. Makanya salah satu lembaga di Inggris mengatakan di tahun 2028 seharusnya sudah terjadi itu sudah overdeck dari Amerika. Nah, kemudian berikutnya kita agak singkat saja di apa konsekuensinya dari perubahan ini. Menurut saya ini yang menjadi penting sebagai satu pemahaman paling tidak dalam konteks kita melihat. Tadi kalau Bang Muli menekankan yang penting bagaimana kita itu punya tekanan atau fokus pada pembangunan nasional kita. Nah ini kan berarti kita bicara nasional interest. Kita nasional interest kita, kepentingan nasional kita berada pada posisi apa dalam situasi ini. Kalau menurut saya memang secara umum, secara diplomasi, secara diplomatik, kita memang harus bersahabat dengan semuanya. Kita jangan cari masalah, maksudnya jangan ngajak juga mereka perang, maksudnya hancur juga kita dengan nuklir. Ya, kan? Tapi ya, tapi secara spesifik dalam kebijakan-kebijakan kita harus bisa jeli melihat mana yang menguntungkan dalam posisi sekarang ini. Misalnya yang bisa menopang benar hilirisasi kita ini mana? Apa kebijakan dari seperti apa? Apakah negara-negara yang selama ini memang sudah sangat dekat dengan kita dan bisa mau apa namanya membantu kita dalam pinjaman dan segala macam, mereka juga bersedia menopang hilirisasi. Ternyata misalnya kayak Eropa kan agak ini juga ya, makanya kemarin agak apa namanya keberatan juga kita menghentikan ekspor nikel gitu ya. mereka agak keberatan juga di situ. Nah ini masih sektor-sektor itu baru satu sektor nih, kalau belum ada 21 sektor yang direncanakan akan dilakukan hilirisasi oleh pemerintahan mendatang Prabowo Gibran. Itu berarti akan lebih banyak lagi nih kemungkinan gesekan-gesekan di tingkatan global dengan berbagai negara. Nah, bagaimana kita mengantisipasi itu? Kemudian dalam hal juga hubungannya nanti itu dengan industrialisasi tentu saja. Kemudian kedaulatan pangan. Kedaulatan pangan bagaimana kita mengatur supaya namanya mana nih negara-negara yang bersedia bekerja sama secara setara, secara adil untuk kita atau kepentingan kita ke depan. Nah, jadi kalau tekanan international interest menurut saya seperti itu. Jadi kita bisa memang dalam hal secara diplomatik kita harus tetap berkawan dengan semuanya. Tapi dalam praktek kebijakan memang butuh dipilah-pilah lagi lebih spesifik. Kemudian saya sebenarnya kemarin itu agak-agak ini sebenarnya waktu kita ikut dalam pertemuan diundang ke pertemuan BRICS di Afrika Selatan ya, itu kan sempat muncul gencar isu bahwa kita akan bergabung ke dalam BRICS ya, kita akan bergabung ke dalam BRICS, tetapi pada akhirnya tidak pemerintah Indonesia memutuskan untuk masih memikirkan lagi lebih panjang, jadi tidak menyatakan menolak tapi tidak menerima, mengatakan akan berpikir lagi. Nah, saya sendiri melihat BRICS ini masih dalam kerangka multipolar itu ya, dengan Pak Maruf ya, bahwa ini memang konsekuensi dari ada kekuatan menurun dan kekuatan-kekuatan baru dunia yang muncul, dan yang memang seperti itulah tatanan dunia yang akan seharusnya lebih adil. Kalau tatanan dunia pasca yang ada sekarang, misalnya yang PBB sekarang kan pasca Perang Dunia Kedua ya, lahir dari Perang Dunia Kedua, para pemenangnya yang punya hak veto semua di sana. Amerika, Inggris, Prancis, Rusia, Cina, mereka yang punya hak veto di PBB, yang lainnya nggak punya. Jadi menurut saya ini kalau kita mau bicara multipolar memang harus ada perombakan atau reformasi termasuk ke soal-soal seperti itu. Bagaimana Palestina mau merdeka kalau begitu dibela, diajukan satu ini langsung diveto oleh Amerika, Inggris. Ya. Jadi nggak akan selesai-selesai itu soal-soal seperti itu. Jadi memang butuh perombakan juga di PBB-nya kalau dalam tingkat internasional. Ya, jadi itu kupikir ya, sebagai satu ini aja, sebagai trigger aja untuk diskusi kita. Ya. Oke, mau jelaskan lagi? Oke. Tim Anderson, Togi Hirmi, Kenny Hirmi. I just address my talk about the international situations, and I think that the point is about the change of the world is start at 2007, I think, when the U.S. Financial crisis, in supply market crisis, that make some change when China and Russia start their dollarization is one point of the change of hegemonic power in the world. And then I also mentioned about how the China's economic growth and the decline of U.S. economy as well. And at the military aspect, also we see the how the brief of Russia to challenge United States in Ukraine, and it's something make a difference. And we also live in the liberal world order that start especially after the World War, Cold War, since the end of the Cold War in 90s. And then now the people in the world start to see this in different ways, that the liberal liberalism ideology is not sweet anymore for all of the people. It's sweet for the rest, but not for the rest. So it's a some kind of a challenge to the liberalism. That's like in Indonesia we have Pancasila, but maybe it's not sweet to liberalism. So we in each of the countries, each of nations, they have their own values, their own systems that suits with themselves. So this is some basic for the multipolarism. I think the nationalism is include the basic for the multipolarism world. So yeah, I think this is my point, and we can continue with the discussions.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Domingos. I interest to Mr. Tim Anderson. I want to ask you about if we talk about multipolarism, from Mr. Mulia said, multipolar not depends on a specific ideology. Multipolar is built by the national spirit or nationalism spirit. So what can we understand about the ideology of multipolarity, Mr.
Fingers.
Hello, Tim. Can you hear me?
Hello. Yes. Thank you.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. There's some music in the background. No, I agree with Dr. Amri, and I think Mr. Dominguez said the same thing, that the principles of non-alignment, you know, a movement that was created by the Republic of Indonesia and other independent countries many decades ago, are very important in this time, because we're living in a dangerous time, really, with the decline of the hegemon for the last few decades. You know very well that in other parts of the world, there are some very serious proxy wars, and they've all been started by the US and its allies, basically, because they fear new poles of power emerging in the world, particularly in the Eurasian region, the links between Asia and Europe, and, you know, with Russia and Eastern Europe in between, for example, and in West Asia, where I am at the moment, for example. So it's a dangerous time, and I think those principles of non-alignment remain very important, both for strategic reasons and developmental reasons. I think Dr. Amri mentioned this, that there's a developmental case for remaining independent and adhering to those principles of independence there. I mean, at the moment, for example, this was exemplified, the difference between the US and China's approach to this period was exemplified by a conversation between Anthony Blinken and his counterpart in China, that Blinken said that people who aren't at the table will become on the menu. In other words, a very arrogant statement, which suggested that only the big powers would determine things and other players would be eaten up in international relations. And the Chinese foreign minister rejected that very strongly. In other words, there is a commitment on the part of China to anti-exceptionalism. Exceptionalism is what drives this project of Anglo-American liberalism or Anglo-American neoliberalism, which I say is a definite historical political project and not just a philosophy or a set of policies. Really, it's always involved double standards. The freedoms, the liberties, the rights have always pertained to elite groups designated by first the British and then the Americans these days. So we can't waste too much time looking for consistency or a lack of hypocrisy in that type of liberalism. Of course, I know other people like the idea of universal rights and freedoms, an idealistic sort of liberalism. There is several currents of thought there, but the project of the Anglo-Americans has always been one of essentially double standards and exceptionalism. In other words, the rules do not apply to them. And we see that very clearly, for example, in the conflict in Palestine at the moment. where the US pretends to be a mediator, but of course it's a sponsor of one side, of the occupier, of the Israeli colonists, for example. And the Chinese role is rather different. Now, I know that in the Asian and Southeast Asian region, there are countries... Sorry, I'm sorry.
Satu abis tengah Jakarta ya.
Keliling.
Iya lah. Dari...
There are countries that have problems with China. For example, the Philippines has some problems with China, and they're to do with offshore islands and some territorial disputes and so on. The problem for the Philippines is they have to look and see the dangers that have happened when the US has intervened and created a proxy war, that is to say, to find a point of weakness and to try and use another country to pursue the ends of US power. We see that in Ukraine at the moment, a tremendous sacrifice, a tremendous loss of life amongst the Ukrainian population, because it's in the interest of the US to try and preserve its hegemony in the world, and it's willing to sacrifice large numbers of young Ukrainian men to burn up in that terrible war, which is a futile war, a losing war, to try and weaken Russia, for example. I think that's the danger that now presents all of us in this region with China, for example. My country, Australia, is being drawn into this confrontation with China, which is our biggest trade partner, with which we've developed good relations over many decades. And now, because the hegemonic power is fearing a loss of influence and fearing a rival which is going to displace it, which I suggest is not exactly true, but nevertheless, that's the way the US sees it, that they want to draw in their so-called partners in the region in this project to try and, for example, create some sort of independent Taiwan, or create some disputes in Western China, in Xinjiang, for example, or pursue issues in Hong Kong, for example. It's a very dangerous path, and I think the principles of the non-aligned movement are very relevant there. Now, in relation to de-dollarization, which Mr. Dominguez raised, I think that's an important thing too, because the question of the dictatorship of the dollar now is a very important developmental as well as a strategic issue. Strategically, it's been used against the independent states, which are seen as outside the ambit of US hegemony and therefore designated as enemies in some sort of way and subject to what they call sanctions, unilateral sanctions. So under the UN order these days, they're called unilateral coercive measures because they violate international law in a number of respects. But we have about 25 to 30 countries directly subject to these sorts of sanctions, and the weapon to enforce them is the dollar and the SWIFT system based in Europe, but which the US controls basically. So countries like Syria and Iran and Cuba and Venezuela and others are subject to this type of siege measures to starve their populations to induce some sort of political change in those measures. At the same time, the dominance of the dollar has serious developmental problems on all other countries. Basically, it's not in the interests of, say, Indonesia to transact in the dollar the whole time, because it will run down the rupiah, it will run down a number of developmental aspects of the Indonesian economy, basically. So that's why, of course, the main manifestation of multipolarity today in the BRICS has at the center of its considerations this year in particular the question of how to at least create alternatives to the dollar. Let's not say destroy the dollar necessarily, but create alternatives so that everyone is not obliged to run down the value of their own currencies and increase their interest rates of borrowing and so on because of the dictates of Washington, basically. So we see in BRICS also that BRICS in some ways is a haven for escaping this type of hegemony, this type of North American hegemony, because we see now, of course, in BRICS, some countries like Iran and China, which are perceived as rivals to the US, and it's understandable that many countries do not want to become the so-called meat in the sandwich, you know, to be seen as making enemies where they need not make enemies. But nevertheless, there is a coalescence of countries that have been targeted by the US in BRICS, but they're also allies now of the US in BRICS. So it doesn't necessarily designate a hostility to the US to become a member of BRICS. We see Saudi Arabia, the United Arab Emirates, Egypt, which are now members of BRICS. And indeed, that's been a way to escape some of the antagonism that's been created by the North Americans. For example, the Chinese brokering of a reconciliation between Saudi Arabia and Iran is a very important factor in the West Asian region, and no other country could do that. There were attempts by Iraq to do that for a time, but Iraq didn't have the weight to do it. China applying some decent international principles as opposed to exceptionalism, even if in Chinese culture they see themselves as exceptional, nevertheless they abide by established principles of international norms to carry out many of their relations these days, which is not something that the Anglo-Americans have ever done. They've always seen themselves as beyond those sorts of rules. So I think for developmental reasons, to improve terms of trade, to protect currencies, to expand international trade and cooperation, to develop non-coercive relationships, participation of countries in BRICS, is something with very low risks. It may risk, for example, direct aid and direct military aid from the US, but I don't believe that there's a risk in coming under direct attack through unilateral sanctions, for example, by joining BRICS. This is really a bloc that is leading the way in terms of developing new possibilities that outside the coercive measures that are increasingly being enforced by the North Americans. They've talked about free trade in the past. Now they are the greatest purveyors of unilateral sanctions against countries to try and punish countries. And now they're trying to punish China too. China, for all its economic power, for all its weight in international relations, is not doing these sort of coercive measures. Their credit terms are much softer. They don't demand policies, for example, of privatizing public utilities, selling them off to foreign investors, for example. They don't demand the sort of conditions that, for example, the IMF imposed on Indonesia in the Asian crisis in 1997, and which the Indonesian financial system is still living with, basically. So whatever complaints there are about China, I would say be very wary about being dragged into any confrontation, because the US will use whatever conflicts they can see to try and open up, to destabilize, to draw in so-called allies into their war to try and destabilize their perceived rivals, whether it's China, Russia, Iran, Venezuela, for example. The Latin Americans have a long history with this. The Latin Americans have a lot to say about these relationships with the US. And we see now transcontinental relationships, for example, between Iran and China and Venezuela now, very beneficial relationships, escaping these unilateral coercive measures, the siege warfare effectively of the US, backed up by its compliant allies, mainly in Europe, but also weak little countries, peripheral countries like Australia, for example. I hope that, and it's true, I think it was mentioned before by one of the speakers about ASEAN. ASEAN has kept an even keel in terms of its relationships with Russia, which I think is very good to see, even after the conflict in Ukraine. I think that globally, and this applies in Africa and Latin America, and I believe in Southeast Asia too, that the special military operation in Ukraine, which is effectively redrawing the borders of 1991, reincorporating the Russian populations into Russia, are not seen as a threat in the same way that the US invasions of Afghanistan and Iraq were seen. They're quite different sorts of things. And so after the special military operation in Ukraine, it's notable that there's a huge queue of countries lining up to join the BRICS and to take advantage of these new opportunities. And that includes countries that have some history of conflict, you know, China and India, for example, Iran and Saudi Arabia, for example. It is a relative safe zone and one providing new economic benefits because, as we know, the World Trade Organization effectively fell apart in the early part of this century because of the rigged rules and the dissatisfaction with the investment demands and the agreement on agriculture from the part of the US and the Europeans. There weren't the promises that were there in the WTO at the start in the 90s did not materialize. And so countries have looked to bilateral and regional agreements. And now there's a new large alternative in terms of multilateral agreements, which is BRICS, which is able to facilitate some new non-coercive relationships. So I think that's the BRICS is the major form and the major promise of developmental terms, and also escaping this dictatorship of the dollar, which is really causing so much damage. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Tim. Excellent. And the audience will asking you about the question. So, teman-teman, silakan ada yang mau bertanya. Ini langsung saja sesi diskusi. Ya, mungkin zoom-nya diarahin ke penanya ya, biar bisa lebih praktis. Oke, Mr. Cook.
It's working. Bisa saya tukar video. So my question is, Bung Ma'ruf, you said that for to identify whether a country is the victim of hegemony, we can see the culture of whether we use, do we use American verdict or not, or Chinese verdict or not? I think I see multipolarity in the industrial specialization that happened now. For example, Japan, sexist and automotive, and then Korean, it's with its culture, K-drama, and also and then gastro diplomacy, we have Thailand. So I see multipolarity happening there. Can I say the country that not lead that sector become the victim of multipolarism? For example, in automotive, one automotive, there are 1,000 parts in Iran, and it produces brown goods, right? Like Indonesia. But the brands belong to each other, suppose. Can I say that we're victim of that multipolarism? And also, Apea, you said that to discipline is important to prepare. We need to prepare the people to be more disciplined in order to achieve the thing that we want to see. China, Japan, Japanese, Chinese, Korean, they have great disciplines. You say that to go apart in the polarization. Polarization can be one thing, right? I want to ask, since the globalization happened, is there any sort of identity blurring as you make deep? Or I am by maybe products from many countries that exist in here, and I think it cleans our own culture. Do we face congestion? I mean, who are Indonesia today?
Oh my God.
Who is Indonesia today? And where are we going? Besides discipline, that we need to prepare to save the generalization. We also need to define person. Who are we, or which sector that actually we are strong at? Shall we focus on our culture? There are many cultures, we have so many cultures. We are very diverse. I think that's good thing to prepare. And what do you guys think?
Before dijawab, nanti ada teman-teman yang lain bisa memberikan pertanyaan, boleh menggunakan bahasa Indonesia, nanti kita coba untuk translate. Silakan, atau mau langsung dijawab dulu. Ayo, silakan.
Oke, thank you for the opportunity. My name is Nola, and FYI, my major is international relationship, and of course, I'm very lucky to be a participant in this discussion. So, as far as I know, kebijakan luar negeri Indonesia itu bebas dan aktif, right? Bebas dan aktif. Jadi, ini pertanyaan saya menyambung dengan bridge tadi, karena emang saya juga lagi meneliti soal bridge juga. Apakah dengan bergabungnya Indonesia dengan bridge itu ada seperti kesan tuduhan bahwa Indonesia sudah tidak lagi menganut prinsip bebas dan aktif. And what real and concrete economic benefits if Indonesia join with BRIDGE? Because I saw Prabowo visits China. Okay, thank you.
Oke, okay, terima kasih Bu Dinanto telah memberikan saya kesempatan. Saya tidak bisa bahasa Inggris. Perkenalkan, saya Julie Hasan. Saya dari LMND, pengurus nasional. Menarik, sekalipun ada beberapa penyampaian yang itu saya tidak paham, karena itu bahasa Inggris. Cuman sudah ada diskusi-diskusi kecil yang mungkin itu yang kita laksanakan. Nah, terus apa yang kemudian disampaikan oleh Pak Sekjen terkait dengan BRIDGE maupun tiga setan yang digunakan oleh Amerika Serikat, WTO, IMF dan World Bank. Saya lebih ke soal kita ketahui secara bersama bahwa ekspansi melalui ekonomi yang pertama Amerika Serikat menggunakan tiga instrumen itu. IMF, WTO dan Bank Dunia. Terus BRIDGE berupaya soal apa terkait dengan dolarisasi. Saat ini masih menggunakan dolarisasi yang sudah menggunakan hubungan bilateral dengan mobil dan dua, yaitu Rusia dan China. Saya lebih ke perspektif geologinya. Karena kalau kita melihat secara persaingan antara Amerika dan China, kita melihat lebih ke ekonominya, gitu. Ekspansinya keluar kapitalis. Nah, saya lebih melihat masuk ke dalam secara ideologi. Karena sekalipun yang disampaikan oleh Sekjen tadi soal Amerika itu bisa mencetak dolar sebanyak mungkin, China mungkin demikian dengan money printing. Makanya soal pada konteks ideologinya, saya mungkin itu yang saya kembalikan kepada moderator.
Ya, langsung saja. Tapi sebenarnya from the question, the question is lebih kepada apa internal organisasi ya, organisasi Indonesia. Jadi, tapi untuk pertanyaannya, Ayu mungkin bisa dijawab oleh tim Anderson. Halo tim.
Halo. Halo, yes. Hello, yes. Sorry, I didn't hear the full question.
Oh, Tim, can you hear me? Okay, I'll send the question for you. I already sent the question for you, but I think I will answer that very quickly, so that's why your answer will more better. Oke, tadi namanya siapa, Gus?
Ayu.
Ayu, Robert Ayu. Berarti kenangan siapa? Awal, what we call your Gen Z?
Yes.
Gen Z. Your question is very mature. Sangat dewasa sekali. So I repeat your question. So your question is the lack of multi-large, how to identify ourselves, how to identify the function of technology. So that's connected to the issue of multi-polarity. Okay, my answer is multi-polarity has any layer, yeah, any layer, any kind of differentiation of answer. Okay, the level of human being, we are who we are, who Indonesian people, like if we ask who American people, who Russian people, Soviet people, who are Chinese people, how can relate to the state to the our identity? So there is a process how to be human being identity and connect to the national identity. And between human being identity and national identity, there is a process. Let's call it industry. So if you say, yeah, if we buy a car from Japan, if we buy a motorcycle from Japan, if we buy a mobile phone from China, do we are in a trap of hegemony or not?
So
if we ask to Mr. Prabowo, do Mr. Prabowo win? Yeah, well from China, do Mr. Prabowo feel that it is subject of hegemony on? It depends on how they identify Mr. Prabowo as human being, as the state person, statesman, and of course it is kind of universal question. Okay, it's not universal question. So that's why multipolarity is universality against homogeneity. So if we identify unipolarity, they want to promote homogenization, universalism. So like Mr. Domingo said about Fukuyama, the end of history is liberal democracy. Is it liberal democracy the end of history? Is the end of Indonesian history? If we are not asking enough and we are in a settle in idle, so we are in track of hegemony. Okay? If we think that the purpose of Indonesian development by Sukarno is liberal democracy, I don't think so. I don't think so. Prosperity, okay, yes. Happiness, okay, yes. Happy? No? No? Okay. Whatever you mention, that human being can perfect. Either they are in the bad way or in the right way. So according to the human being, it has a human nature to be bad or to be good. But the supreme one is to be good. But in the Western perspective, like the unipolarity is bad. Human being is more bad than good. Okay, like phobia, Okay, they are exceptionalists. Yeah, outside of United States should be surrendered, should be bold. Okay, we have to follow what the foreign policy, United States foreign policy. Yeah, according to the state solution. If you ask me, do it is the best choice in a diplomacy to state solution of addressing Israel and Palestine? No, at all. It is addressed by the leader of United States. How can we say a two-state solution if the leader of Israel, they don't admit Palestinian state? It's hard. So that's why I'll back to the multiple. They have a layer of human being. So we have to consider ourselves as a part of nation honor. For me, if I want to develop my identity and my nationality, so I do not want to stuck in the nation state. Because why? Because China's perspective, Russia perspective, nation state is a product of modernity. They said about civilization state because they have ancestors. So they have ancestors. Said about Majapahit, Sriwijaya, and also in Muslim community, I was connect to the kingdom of Melayu, Muslim kingdom, or Hindu's kingdom. So that we have to connect not only start independent, Indonesian independent. Yeah, August 18, 1945. So again, multipolarity is the awareness to be a human being, to be free, just like in the preamble of Indonesian. Constitution, kemerdekaan adalah hak segala. So
not only a matter of how do we have to close enough to United States, close enough to Russia, close enough to China. It is secondary. The most important thing, how Indonesia to be a free. Because we are going to be free. But of course, not free on the perspective of Fukuyama, not the perspective of Rocky Group. The Rocky Group is part of Western liberal democracy. They are very, very strict, yeah, from the argumentation. So far, I said Rocky Group is part to be subject of the game, to be part of Western hegemony, not Indonesian civilization. That's my answer. Okay? Oke, okay. Again, of course ya, ketika kita sekali lagi ya, ada logika namanya fungsionalis, ada logika namanya justice. Ya, di dalam filosofi ini hanya ada tiga aja. Itu fungsionalis, ketika Anda menjadi seorang penguasa, menjadi seorang menteri, yang penting itu established, everybody happy. Yang penting sistem itu bekerja. Yang kedua, keadilan justice. Ada gap, kaya miskin, ada concern di situ, akses partai Dominus misalnya, justice. Tidak tahu partai ini ideologinya apa sih? Pastilah. Ah, pasti nggak boleh ya, sosialis boleh ya. Makanya tadi kita tanya, sosialis. Because Marxis, komunis itu ada. Tapi maaf, primer ya. Oke, ya, ada tiga, fungsionalis, ya, Marxis, justice. Seorang Marxis, seorang sosialis, dia akan nggak bisa tidur kalau dia itu pertanyaan-pertanyaan keadilan belum terjawab. No justice, no peace. Hidupnya ada untuk keadilan. Nah, tadi saya diskusi dengan Prof. Jimli sebelum diskusi. Dia ingin mengevaluasi hasil MK. Saya bilang pada diri saya, no. Hukum tujuan utamanya itu adalah justice. Not justice. Sorry. Not justice. Justice itu keadilan itu barang abstrak di tangan hakim. Dia positifis. Positif harus ada keputusan. Yang jadi presiden ini tiga paslon siapa? That's good. Agree. But more than that, ketika keputusan MK menentukan Presiden Republik Indonesia ABC, tapi kedepannya tidak bisa mensejahterakan, what's wrong? Keadilan. Kita bilang keadilan. Oke. Okay. Lembaga hak asasi manusia keadilan paling penting, keadilan cuma justice, tapi nggak ada prosperitas. Itulah kenapa cara berpikir the way Chinese modern right now is seperti itu. Dia nggak mau didesakkan, dipojokkan menjadi negara yang anti demokrasi. Karena apa? Demokrasi is product of different words. Dia bukan Tuhan. Liberal democracy is not God. Ya, hanya cara berpikir saja. Ya, instrumen. Bukan tujuan. Kalau Pak Rocky Group, kalau ditanya, liberal demokrasi tujuan. Kebebasan. Kebebasan untuk siapa? Untuk manusia. Manusia untuk kebebasan. Tidak ada logika sirkular. Ending. Mana lebih dulu, telur apa ayam? Ya, kok telur-telur? Ada endingnya. Maka itu. Kita silahkan itu. Maksudnya di situ. Harus. Pak Prabowo harus menentukan. Straight. Oke, itu ya ada layer mati keluar nanti. Kemudian soal how to be independent dengan speaker yang dari Golkar, pemikir Golkar is very excellent. Soal independent, jadi ada hubungan antara liberal demokrasi dengan to be independent. Seolah-olah ini barang ini Indonesia ada jebakan historis menjadi Indonesia yang independen, nggak mau ke Amerika, nggak mau ke China, nggak mau Rusia, mau ke mana? Independen saja, sesuai dengan bebas aktif. Oh, tapi hati-hati, aktifnya kemana? Nggak jauh-jauh dengan aktifnya. Bisa lihat dari Minister of Defense, berapa banyak alutsista kita beli dari Amerika, dari China, dari Rusia, itu gampang. Karena beli alat alutsista itu bagian dari kita patah gimana. Karena soal militer itu kan bukan soal hanya beli. Kalau Anda beli motor, beli mobil seperti ini, tapi kalau alutsista itu menentukan who is the enemy. Makanya kita bingung nih, kalau kita perang sama Australia, AUKUS, kita bingung. Karena kita menjadi just, itu makna dari multipolarity. ketika tentara-tentara kita ada kesadaran multipolarity, maka kita ya ya kalau perang sama Australia barang-barangnya dari satu pabrik gimana nih? Yang menang apa? Kita harus membangkitkan multipolarity di berbagai level. Oke ya. Jadi untuk menjadi independen, bebas, aktif itu intinya makanya saya punya teori geopolitik Pancasila itu harus dihidupkan oleh BPIP. Harus dihidupkan oleh BPIP karena dia adalah pembinaan ideologi Pancasila. Dia sebagai badan yang menghadirkan menteri membina paling tahu ideologi itu BPIP orang-orang dia bekerja di BPIP juga di seluruh negara. Dia harus di atasnya itu dengan produksi-produksi teori-teori baru itu yang saya nggak lihat di Indonesia. Bikin Kongres Pancasila mengundang pemikir-pemikir seluruh dunia di hotel yang paling mahal. Itu yang dilakukan Cina dan Rusia. Maaf ya, saya belum pernah ke Amerika, belum pernah ke Cina, belum pernah. Tapi sebagian besar, itu yang saya sampaikan itu soal tentang hal-hal yang global itu dia harus number one. Budget negara harus harus ada itu, pemikir-pemikir bagaimana memperjuangkan bebas aktif, bagaimana bebas aktif ini tidak sah. Jadi yang mungkin Minister of Foreign Affairs harus ada akademi Kementerian Luar Negeri, Kementerian bagian dari BPI, ada masyarakat, militer senior, orang yang sadar tentang senior militer. Perang itu kan juga harus di sesuatu yang harus diinovasi. Gitu. Jadi kita belum ngomongin perang. Kemudian Indonesia idol nih mau jadi anggota BRICS apa enggak nih? Kalau enggak kan ya kita tahu ya Pak SBY enggak sih. Karena bertolak belakangnya ideologi kita kan gitu. Is it true? Kita harus elaborasi. Karena itu kita harus mengundang Pak SBY secara terbuka kemudian semuanya didiskusikan adalah proses itu semuanya. Ya itu aja kan. Dan yang lain juga bisa tim mungkin ya mungkin dia ada waktunya sangat sedikit.
Oke,
ya Mr. Tim, please give your explanation about the question. Maybe one of the question is ideology perspective. The question from audience, sorry. The ideology perspective about the rivalry between BRICS and IMF, World Bank, and Europe. Europe groups. How can we see the ideologies in this discourse?
Okay, thank you very much. Yes, I think that was an important last point you made, that you see the ideology of Anglo-American, what I call Anglo-American liberalism or Anglo-American hegemonic liberalism, in those institutions of the World Bank and the IMF and the whole, all of the history of structural adjustment and so on that many of us argued about and passed through at the end of the last century, basically. So Anglo-American hegemonic neoliberalism to me is a selective use of those liberal ideas of individual rights and freedoms, but privileging the exceptional groups, just as they privilege their colonies, like the Israeli colony, for example. And so we see the actual expression of those ideologies through the terrible colonial crimes in Gaza, in Palestine at the moment. In terms of BRICS and multipolarity, I don't believe there is really a multipolar ideology or a BRICS ideology at the moment, because it's really constructed as an antithesis to unipolarity or exceptional hegemonic dominance or imperialism even. And so the constituent members of the BRICS, they have their own necessarily pluralistic ideologies. I say this because I think BRICS and multipolarity implies a necessary pluralism of values. You know, Indonesia has Pancasila, Iran has its Islamic civilization ideas, Russia has its traditional ideas of Russian culture and Russian civilization. So we have a range of different ideologies and values, but they come together and coalesce in certain shared principles. And it's notable, I think, that there is a group at the UN now, I can't remember all the members, I know China's a member, it's 19 or 20 countries that are committed to defending the principles of the UN Charter. So, and of course, in UN norms, we have to include the post-colonial norms from the Declaration on Decolonization in 1960 and the twin charters of human rights in the mid-1960s. So all of those post-colonial principles of self-determination of nations, the principles of non-intervention and so on, and the principles written into the UN Charter are things that are effective norms created by the international community with some, you know, particular historical influences, but in contradistinction to the hegemonic order, which says we must have a single superpower which rules and polices the world and enforces itself to stabilize the world and supposedly provide public goods or common goods to everyone through this type of stability. But in reality, we know the particular interests of that hegemon have been extremely destructive and continue to be extremely destructive in these hybrid wars, in these sieges and so on. So multipolarity in many respects is a refuge from unipolarity, that the idea is there will not be a single pole of power in the world, but rather various poles of power and relations that carry on under international principles and not under the exceptional ideology of some dominant giant, basically. So it's not to say that there's going to be totally symmetrical relationships between peoples, between nations, because we know there are some very big powers and there are some very small countries, but nevertheless, there can be non-coercive relationships and cooperation on a non-coercive level that we see in a number of regional organizations already, but this is, of course, is a multilateral institution, BRICS, I mean. So I don't think there is a particular ideology except to reject the idea of domination by a single dominant hegemon, which is part of the North American ideology. Mainly it's North American, really. Accept and welcome that necessary pluralism. We see in regional organizations, like in Latin America, for example, they have the CELAC group, which includes all of the Latin American Caribbean nations. They have the ALBA group, which has some more progressive principles. And we see an emerging West Asian group with Iran, Iraq, Syria, Yemen, countries that are involved in resistance to the colonization going on in Palestine, for example. So I think there's going to be a necessary pluralism, rejection of the idea of a central dominant power in BRICS. And so the ideology is going to be a reversion to traditional post-colonial and UN internet principles, mostly of international law. I don't think we'll see a new set of values emerging. Maybe they will be created, but I think that the inspiration for particular values in particular cultures will continue, whether they're religious values, whether they're historical cultural values, but they will have to come together in new forms in multipolar institutions. For example, how would you characterize the values or the ideology of the relationship between Iran and Russia, Iran and Russia and Venezuela? You know, they have very different cultures, very different histories, but they've come together for many reasons, including that they want to assert their independence as cultures, as nationalities, as states representing independent peoples, which is entirely consistent with the post-colonial culture. So that's the best I can say in terms of multipolar ideology. Thank you very much.
Sorry, Tim. I want to give you a question about how do we know clearly about the, maybe this is the rumor or I don't know, discourse maybe,
Well, the group of elite global or elite America, can you explain about your opinion about or your research about the researching about the elite America or elite global?
Yes, I mean, there are differences in the way analysts have looked at this idea in the neo-Marxist tradition, for example. In my view, there is no real Western bloc. There is a Anglo-American bloc. Effectively, the British began it and began these liberal elite ideas, and the North Americans have taken over it. And now the global hegemony is led by a single powerful state, basically. And even you can see in the relationships between the US and the European states sacrificing themselves, for example, over the Nord Stream pipeline, over Ukraine, for the sake of US hegemony. So I really think the elite is a traditionally an Anglo-American one, and particularly a North American one. I hesitate to say American because you know that the US is only one third of the Americas. But that Anglo-American elite is a dominant one, and they have others that they incorporate from time to time. But if you look at what happened to the German economy, to German industry in recent times, because Germany as a occupied state, as a state that had been really subordinated to the US for the last 80 years, has really sacrificed a lot of its historical advantages for the sake of this US project to try and isolate and weaken Russia, basically. So I think that emphasizes more than ever that there, to the extent that, for example, the European elites participate in this hegemonic project, they are really expendable. They don't really have, and any ally of the US, they do not really regard as equals or share as equals with any of their allies, their dominance. They really reserve it for themselves. Even though, of course, the cross linkages between the oligarchs in North America and Europe, there's very strong cross linkages. And that's, of course, it helps explain why the Europeans also find it very difficult to have a different policy position in relation to Iran, for example, because they are effectively governed by and dominated by US law. The US says if any company has 10% US shares, the US Treasury can discipline it and impose fines, as they have against European banks. You know, they've fined European banks. The US Treasury has fined European banks hundreds of millions of dollars for, in the past, doing business with Iran and Cuba and other countries. You know, so the US is clearly the dominant player in this global hegemonic oligarchy.
Okay, thank you, Dim. I got you. And I will back to the question for Elias. Enough for you, Dim. Mungkin tadi Bang Mulia pengen banget jawab pertanyaan dari Ayu. Mungkin bisa nanti dikombain dengan pertanyaan yang tadi soal terbuka dan ya pertanyaan kedua dari yang silakan, Bang.
Okay, so thank you, Pak Ayu, and juga I'll try to answer a question from Mbak Nola here. And I will try to link it back to development. In the first round, I also mentioned about development. Because Golkar is development party, yeah? Partai pembangunan. So, geopolitics, I'll try to link it back to pembangunan. Ya, bukan lagi dengan pembangunan. Kali ini soal multipolarism. Multipolarism is in line with the definition of development as mentioned by Amartya Sen. Amartya Sen is a Nobel Prize winner for economics. And he defined development as enlargement of choices. Jadi pembangunan itu harusnya merupakan kita mempunyai lebih banyak pilihan. When we are more developed, we can choose whether to have coffee or tea. When we are less developed, less choice, only coffee, no tea. When we are even more developed, you can choose, okay, I choose coffee or tea or juice, I choose coffee. And then you choose coffee, okay, which coffee do you want? Robusta, Arabica. Arabica, which Arabica do you want? Sumatra, Gayo, Papua, and all that. The more choices we have, yeah, more developed. So, unipolar, no choice. No choice. In the past,
kita tidak punya pilihan. Waktu zaman-zaman dulu semua film ada film judulnya di Indonesia, hampir semua film luar adalah film Hollywood. Sekarang kita punya banyak sekali pilihan, film India, film Korea sekarang banyak. Jadi multipolarism adalah kita punya lebih banyak pilihan. Kita mau mengikuti ala Korea, ala China, ala Amerika, ala Arab, boleh sekarang. Kalau dulu, oh my god, keras. Yeah. Kalau dulu happy birthday, sekarang barang masih murid. Gak apa-apa, kita lebih banyak pilihan aja ya. Asal sama-sama kita anggap sebagai ya pilihan aja. It's okay, saya mau style Amerika, happy birthday, bro. Gitu kan, saya mau pakai style Arab, it's okay. Baru kalau si Dominic, ya memang lebih banyak pilihan. Pakai ala Korea, siapa tahu cara Korea ya kan? It's okay, itu lebih banyak pilihan. Semakin multipolar, semakin lebih banyak pilihan yang semakin bagus. Dan semakin terbuka kemungkinan kita untuk ikut di sana. Kalau cuma jemur kan susah. Kalau lebih banyak pilihan kan lebih mudah bagi kita untuk menaruh Indonesia ada di sana sebagai salah satu pilihan. Jadi multipolarism allows us with more choices. And you mentioned about Thai food, Korean culture. Bring it on, more culture please. I want to hear about Iranian culture. I want to hear about Nigerian culture. So bagus. Dan ketika itu terjadi dari dunia luar juga. Okay, I want to see about Indonesian culture. I want to see about Indonesian products. So itu lebih bagus. Jadi lebih banyak multipolar, lebih banyak pilihan, lebih sejalan dengan pembangunan. Tentunya di sini kita harus juga pastikan bahwa Indonesia sendiri tidak ketinggalan. Jangan sampai multipolar, tapi tidak ada Indonesianya. Ya harus ada dong Indonesianya. Kalau misalnya kita belum kuat, ya kita berdaya. Maka Indonesia juga bisa menjadi salah satu dari pilihan dunia. Ya contohnya, K-pop udah nembus Hollywood, ya kan? K-pop udah nembus musik di Amerika. Ya ke depan kita berdayakan musisi-musisi kita agar juga bisa menembus panggung dunia. Dan K-pop itu, K-pop became a strong cultural force at the world level. It's a lot of that is supported by the government. The Korean government chose to do an active policy to support local artists. Did you know that if you are a boy band, you want to practice, you can use a studio for free. Government provides studio. Of course, you have to register. And you can use your studio for free. This government facility to enable to strengthen local artists, local musicians. So multipolarity, very good, in line with government, in line with development, more choices. Now about BRICS. BRICS has now become a geopolitical terminology. Yeah, BRICS akhirnya menjadi geopolitis. Padahal awalnya BRICS itu nggak ada kaitannya sama geopolitik sedikit lah urusannya. BRICS was coined in 2001 by someone from Goldman Sachs. Ya, urusannya BRICS itu karena BRICS adalah new emerging economies. As simple as that. Waktu itu tahun 2001, Indonesia was just recovering from the crisis. So Indonesia's economy has not rebounded back yet. Belum bangkit lagi setelah Krismon. Jadi Indonesia nggak masuk di sana. Dan itu bukan sebuah asosiasi negara-negara yang kemudian orang harus apply membership. Itu kebetulan aja ada seorang investment banker, wah ini negara-negara ini nih, pertumbuhan ekonominya bagus selama beberapa tahun terakhir. Saya akan menyebut mereka. Padahal simple, ya itu adalah newly emerging economies that did very well in terms of GDP growth in the past few years. Lalu kemudian di tahun 2005-2006, ada sekelompok negara-negara baru yang pertumbuhan ekonomi juga bagus. Lalu itu sempat muncul, ada orang investment lagi yang menyebutkan, muncul BIN, Mexico. In English. So in 2005-2006, there's even someone else who saw that in the past few years, there are other countries which GDP growth was as good. So there was Mexico,
Indonesia, Nigeria, Turkey. It was very much an economic and investment terminology. So that people, okay, if you want have, if you have some extra money, go invest in these countries. They were doing very well in terms of GDP growth and investment. So it's as simple as that. Nowadays, it's a little bit more controversial and more politics and more geopolitics to talk about BRICS. In the beginning, it was not just, it was just a simple thing about economic growth. And don't forget that in 2001, China just joined the WTO a year before, in 2000. China was not yet as strong as they are now. Russia was also still recovering from the end of the Cold War. Yeah, India was just going up. Yeah, so it was simply a term for newly emerging economies. Now, nowadays, if you talk about BRICS, it has become a little bit more controversial because what does it mean? Mungkin maksudnya, if kalau sekarang join ke BRICS lebih kontroversial karena andanya it means that you're not with the West. Like, that's not what we wanted. It was simply a term for economically interesting countries to invest in. Sekarang dengan China udah lebih kuat, Rusia lagi ada isu dengan perang segala macam, terus kita join BRICS, it's more like a geopolitical statement now, yeah. But in 2001, if we were included in the BRICS, it was an acknowledgement that Indonesia was doing very well economically. Now, of course, going back to bebasan aktif, yeah, free non-aligned principles, if Indonesia were to join BRICS and being ready to be branded as non-Western, siap untuk join BRICS, lalu kemudian dicap, oh ini anti-Barat atau tidak setuju dengan Barat, ya harusnya kita seimbangkan. Kita seimbangkan Indonesia masuk OECD. OECD isinya negara-negara Barat yang westernized democracy. Indonesia is also fine to join OECD, which is more aligned to the Western interest. Maybe, well, of course, nowadays the OECD is still reviewing and all that. Maybe if OECD has already approved Indonesia to join, maybe it would be more balancing if we also go into BRICS. The point is that we don't want to be branded as choosing any side. We want to be working. Kita ingin bekerjasama dengan semua negara di dunia. Dan kita tidak ingin menciptakan musuh. Tidak ingin dicap sebagai memihak kepada suatu, karena semua negara merupakan partner dagang, partner pertukaran budaya yang setara. Dan itu yang ingin kita capai, karena apa? Kembali lagi, kita ingin enlargement of choices, memperluas pilihan bagi rakyat Indonesia. Kembali lagi ke bangunan. Thank you, makasih.
Open, tapi harus open-minded. Ya. Okay, thank you, Bang Mulia. Sekarang akhirnya Bung Dom akan menjawab pertanyaan dari Zulfikar yang sebenarnya tadi sudah dijelaskan oleh tim tadi soal bagaimana rivality between BRICS and USA groups, sorry, United Kingdom and groups dan BRICS. Jadi seperti apa tensi kira-kira yang dihadirkan oleh rivalitas grup ini?
Ini saya menjawab dari sudut pandang pertanyaan tadi tentang dasar teori ideologinya ya. Kalau tadi tim sebenarnya sudah menjawab terus menjelaskan sedikit bahwa sebenarnya lebih plural ya ideologi yang ada dalam dunia polar ya, termasuk BRICS, masing-masing negara punya ideologi sendiri atau punya cara pandang sendiri. Nah, tapi yang menarik atau ini bisa ditarik satu kesamaannya itu adalah mereka punya satu dasar kepentingan yang sama, satu misi yang sama untuk mengkonter ya, ideologi yang selama ini dominan baik di Iran, di Venezuela, di Rusia, China dan lain-lain. Nah, Kalau BRICS sendiri tadi juga tim sempat sebut bahwa memang tidak apa namanya ada seperti yang tadi dibilang Bang Oli bahwa ada semacam kecenderungan gitu ya. Kalau kita masuk ke sini berarti sudah berada satu blok yang berbeda. Nah, tetapi juga tadi tim sebut bahwa di sana juga ada negara-negara yang sebenarnya kecenderungannya ke barat juga, ya, seperti Mesir ya, yang baru bergabung. Kemudian Arab Saudi, kemudian ada juga India di sana sebelumnya. India ini sebenarnya memainkan posisinya lebih balance ya, antara mau ke barat dan ke timur. Nah, sebenarnya kita juga sebenarnya bisa mengambil posisi demikian. Benar, kita sudah mengapply juga masuk ke OECD dan apa namanya kalau ke BRICS memang belum ya. Tapi kemungkinan besar ini pertemuan berikutnya bisa jadi sudah masuk karena OECD sudah diproses dan kalau tidak salah sudah di-approve ya. Sudah di-approve oleh negara-negara di OECD dan kota Indonesia saat ini. Nah, kalau ditarik ke soal ideologinya atau lebih secara teoritisnya, pertama kalau ideologi memang menonjolnya kemudian nasionalisme atau regionalisme. Kalau regionalisme mungkin kita nanti di diskusi berikutnya bisa bahas lebih spesifik dalam ya soal ASEAN misalnya sebagai satu kekuatan tadi ini juga sebut dengan 500 juta penduduk dan ekonomi yang sangat besar ASEAN sebenarnya punya potensi tapi di dalam sendiri pun tidak homogen karena masing-masing punya orientasi juga ya Filipina yang sangat kental dengan Amerika kemudian kita yang besar mental kemudian ada juga Vietnam yang beragam jadi lebih kompleks mungkin situasinya di ASEAN. Nah, tetapi itu kalau sementara kalau lebih teoritisnya saya ingin mengemukakan satu apa namanya satu pandangan atau satu hasil riset ya yang dibuat oleh seorang profesor namanya Michael Hudson. Ini sudah sering saya sebutkan namanya. Dia seorang ekonom dan dia membagi atau membelah dunia dalam kecenderungan dua kecenderungan dalam pembangunan ekonominya. Yang pertama itu adalah kecenderungan finansialisasi atau pembangunan ekonominya berbasiskan finance. Yang kedua adalah industrialisasi atau berbasiskan industri. Nah, finansialisasi ini dilakukan oleh terutama dipelopori oleh Amerika Serikat. Sementara kalau industrialisasi itu dilakukan oleh China. Ini Michael Hudson, dia memberikan basis teori itu. Dan dia berusaha membuktikan bahwa dengan basis industrialisasi, dengan dasar teori-teori ekonomi klasik, itu ternyata lebih berhasil dibandingkan dengan berdasarkan pada teori-teori neoklasik yang kemudian hasilnya adalah neoklasik yang tidak secara ekonomi tidak terlalu produktif atau tidak produktif bahkan dibandingkan dengan yang klasik ini dan negara-negara yang kemudian menjalankan ekonomi industri ini ya terbukti mengalami peningkatan dan sebaliknya yang finansialisasi itu yang dipegang oleh sedikit elit global ya, itu ternyata mengalami penurunan. Jadi ada pembelahan di situ ya secara teori ekonomi mungkin nanti di bedah berikutnya bisa spesifik ekonomi kita bisa undang yang lebih paham soal ekonomi untuk membedah bagaimana itu berjalan. Nah, kalau judul bukunya atau bisa teman-teman cari di YouTube banyak presentasi dari Michael Hudson itu dia banyak sekali dia membahas soal itu. Apa namanya? Kalau nggak salah ekonomi geopolitikal ekonomi ya tema geopolitikal ekonomi itu dia banyak membahas soal itu nanti kalau nggak bisa belajar bisa atau mendengar paparan dia di sana ada juga bukunya Destiny of Civilizations jadi takdir dari peradaban itu dia membahas juga di situ. Pikir itu kalau mau bedah lebih lanjut nanti mungkin kita untuk waktu khusus ya untuk soal ekonomi karena itu penting lebih spesifik ke ekonomi kalau untuk ekonominya dan pikir
satu di ekonomi, yang kedua di militernya, yang ketiga di budaya. Nah ini bagaimana kita bisa bedah lebih lanjut, kemudian nanti bisa dipecah lagi ke region, regional, mungkin bisa bedah lebih lanjut lagi. Sementara dari saya.
Ya, terima kasih Bung Dom. Saya minta waktunya sebentar para pembicara dan juga tim, please stay in Zoom, because I have a one case question or for audience, from audience. Kita masih ada satu pertanyaan lagi, satu sesi pertanyaan dan juga satu pertanyaan. Ini langsung aja teman-teman, ada yang masih mau bertanya bisa dengan bahasa Indonesia, nanti di translate.
Di Zoom ada pertanyaan apa?
Nggak tahu, ini bang masih bisa atau
mana?
Oke, terus.
Maslan.
Kemudian.
Ya.
Ada. Ada sih, ada musim ya.
Kalau nggak ada biar.
Berjalan
tadi. Saya punya pertanyaan. There's no question more, so I think this is the last statement. And can you give your last statement and last maybe question maybe to us for the future and how we cope by the geopolitical and our multipolar thing. Please.
Thank you. Well, just by way of some final comments, I think I'd like to thank the organizers, particularly Dr. Mohamed Maarouf for
hold
this
on, hold on, Tim.
Seminar.
Sorry, hold on. Maybe one package here, what my the question of moderator and me. Your dissertation, I think Marxism, right? Economic Marxism. Is it right? Economic Marxism. So my question is the compatibility Marxism and multipolarity. Due to your main research.
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
The compatibility Marxism, ideology of Marxism or socialism and multipolarity. Is it any relevant enough to understand multipolarity, what we are talking about?
I don't think there's an essential conflict between neo-Marxism and multipolarity. You know, there are different currents of thought in Marxism. Marxism is basically looking at the role, the power of capital, concentration of power in the hands of capital and class struggle. In the 20th century, there were many revisions in the Marxist tradition which allow some new views of international relations and the role of the state in particular. So I don't think there's any essential clash there. To me, Marxism is simply a current in social science, an analysis of particularly European industrial relations in the 19th century, and it's most usefully supplemented by other ideological currents, basically to understand the world. But it's a European-centered thing. It was never particularly strong in its critique of colonialism and neocolonialism, and it's up to those of us in independent blocks these days to talk about that, to apply principles, a range of principles, perhaps including some neo-Marxist principles to these sort of post-colonial discussions. But I think multipolarity is something that really is bringing together, as I said before, a range of different ideologies which are united in their rejection of a unipolar world, a hegemonic world, and demanding a necessary pluralism in values and in relations, basically. So I don't think there's an essential conflict there.
Hello, Tim.
Hello.
I was a bit mentioned about Michael Hudson and his theory about how he compared the development of the China economics and United States economy. And in general, he said that China has a different path of development by using the more industrial development than financialization, referred to United States. So what do you see about that, the comparisons of the financialization economic and industrialization economic that happened in those two countries, like referred to the Michael Hudson? Thank you.
Thank you. I'm not sure that I fully understood the question, but if you are talking about the role of China and the role of the US in terms of economic power and financial power, I think we have to acknowledge that the North Americans remain with their strength in the financial field, particularly through the use of the dollar and the control of the SWIFT system. The Chinese have clearly gone beyond the US and its allies in terms of industrial development and economic development. And, you know, talking about GDP is not enough, is it? We have to look at other things there. There's also an argument to be made that the Chinese have moved ahead in technological development. In several fields of technological development, they've moved ahead of the Anglo-Americans, basically. But undoubtedly, the power of the Anglo-Americans remains in finance and also in media to a degree. So the cultural influence of Anglo-America is still very strong around the world because they dominate the media, they control the major social media too. And so their role in affecting and even constraining people's discussions is very important. You know, certain realms of discussion are shut down in social media. Social media is a great benefit to independent peoples these days, but it's still mediated and controlled. And in that area, we have a battle, basically, because apart from the English language itself, there is this direct control of public debate. So in finance and media, I think the Anglo-Americans are still quite dominant, but in technology, in industrial development, then things have diversified substantially, and we see a number of innovations, even from some very small countries. You know, I'm particularly interested in the fact that the Cubans, who have specialized in education and health, have created new pharmaceuticals, for example, and they get Iran to industrialize them there now because they don't have the capacity in Cuba. So those sort of South-South, that sort of South-South cooperation is opened up, I think, by this multipolar world. And let's not pretend that there isn't the capacity in many nations to contribute to a world of where a better world is possible through these sorts of South-South relations in particular, or more non-coercive forms of cooperation. I'm not sure if I answered that question, but
excellent, and absolutely so clear. We understand what you talk about. So this is enough for you, Mr. Tim. Thank you so much. But I hope we can meet again in the discourse. Yes. not by Zoom, but I want to see you in reality. Because we maybe have a similar same philosophy or same ideology, but I don't know. I still learned about Marxism and socialism, but I don't know. So again, thank you so much. I hopefully your condition always be good in where you are, and so
Oh, sorry, Tim. I almost lost my your before you leave the Zoom. Maybe you can give a closing statement for this one, this discussion. Tim. Hello, Tim.
I'm sorry, say that again, please. Hello, sorry, say that again, please.
Your close statement, closing statement, Tim.
Yes, I just made it actually. Sorry. Thank you for this seminar. I think the discussions about multipolarity and BRICS are particularly important, and particularly the developmental questions there. In some respects, we are focused on the conflict in the world and the strategic struggles. But as has been said by others, the developmental implications of multipolarity and BRICS are very important there and shouldn't be ignored. And these sorts of discussions, I think, help people focus on issues, the real issues that are going to be of particular importance in their spheres. That's all.
Thank you so much. I don't know what can I say again, but this is the first time we do discuss about this topic, especially about geopolitics. So you be nice in this moment. So I'm hopeful in the next time or next discuss, maybe you will join with us again. So enough for you. Thank you very much. Salam Rahayu, Namo Buddhaya. Selamat sore, Tim. Selamat sore.
Selamat sore. Terima kasih.
Thank you so much. Sesi diskusi kita bersama Tim mungkin terakhir, tapi dengan penuh pengamatan dan juga apa namanya ya perhatian. Kita sama-sama akan kembali pada diskusi-diskusi berikutnya. Tapi sebelum kita tutup diskusi kita pada sore hari ini, mari kita dengarkan closing statement dari setiap pembicara. Mungkin diulang lagi, dimulai dari Bang.
Okay, thank you very much. I think sudah kelar ya?
Masih.
I will give a closing statement. The key word is dignity and equality. That is the what we call ideology of multipolarity. If certain country treat other country with equality and dignity, that's become multipolarity. If opposite to them, so they will be hegemon. Okay. Number one. Number two. I think Indonesia should be more discussed, yeah, more open, not only in Western perspective, not only using Western reference, but also Eastern Western. Yeah, we are not talking about bipolarity. Multipolarity not proposing bipolarity. Multipolarity not proposing a new ideology. It's just awareness of the human being to be a free of human being, real free of human being, not fake of human being. If certain country, yeah, want other country to be the definition of freedom like that country, that hegemon. Okay, we have a definition of freedom. We have definition of democracy. We have to make sure that, yeah, what we call it to be independent, not alignment is good as the ancestor heritage,
warisan budaya yang harus kita jaga. Ya, non-aligned movement is very beautiful. Mr. Sukarno have, I think, great effect to the world. If you go to Russia, you will meet the Moscow of Sukarno. If you go to Pakistan, you will see the street of Sukarno, and also in NG. I see in the road talking about Sukarno because of what? Because Sukarno in the past have give a heritage to be human, to be human meaning, to be equality, yeah, to be equal, to be dignity, yeah. To be man is very not very difficult, yeah. But the most important thing, this is another point. Jadi kesalahan Indonesia adalah siap damai, tapi sama sekali tidak siap perang. Tidak mungkin Indonesia menjadi negara besar kalau hanya disoleh peace. Menjadi negara besar butuh cita-cita besar. Menjadi negara sebesar China, to be a great like China, China is not so easy. It's not so difficult at that. Modernisasi efektif, ya, menjadi sumber daya manusia yang unggul dan seterusnya, itu adalah sifat alami manusia. Tapi menjadi negara katakanlah memiliki efek tanpa mendominasi, tapi orang itu respect pada kita, itu luar biasa. Jadi menurut saya menjadi Indonesia yang hebat, Indonesia emas, itu adalah tidak hanya mengeluarkan produk-produk ya, produk-produk unggul, tapi manusia yang unggul, terbuka, seperti dari pemikir Golkar Institute, ya, banyak pilihan, itu saya setuju sekali. Artinya tidak hanya OECD, ya, ada bridge, tapi dilakukan secara terbuka, tidak baik belakang-belakang, secara terbuka. Masyarakat harus tahu, ya, keuntungan dan kelebihannya. Bridge pada awalnya memang ekonomi, tapi karena 15.000 sanksi United States kepada Rusia menjadi geopolitik. Karena Amerika Serikat memberi sanksi pada China menjadi geopolitik. Jadi itu adalah sifat alamnya, ketika orang diinjak dia akan melawan. Persoalannya dia punya deterrence atau tidak. Kira-kira gitu. Nah, Timur Tengah ada kekuatan deterrence. Jadi perang itu bukan in the future of war, in the closing statement. In the future of war, bukan killing mass casualty, human being mass casualty. Enggak. Ketika kita menguasai teknologi militer, kita akan bisa menguasai superiority. Indonesia harus superior di bidang teknologi militer. Sehingga perang ke depan itu bukan perang banyak-banyakan impor, tapi mematikan teknologi lawan. Sebagaimana sorenya ada promosi sendiri. Sebagaimana Iran menyerang Israel. Anda bayangin ya, orang-orang, ya, Anda boleh meremehkan. Ketika, ini sore ya, ketika ada 3 air defense, pertama Iron Dome, David Sling, kemudian Arrow. Ini sebagai contoh saja. Yang pertama adalah 75 km jaraknya, ya, jangkauannya. Yang kedua 350 km, yang ketiga 2500. Ditambah lagi Inggris, ya, kemudian Amerika Serikat, Jordan, Arab Saudi, Emirat. Pesawatnya dikerahkan air defense dan sistem central command, what we call unipolar di bidang militer, unipolar di Timur Tengah itu. Akhirnya kan bisa jatuh, diatur ke Israel, dan Israel tidak melakukan kata-kata. Karena apa? Because of what? Karena F-35 dan Sparrow-nya Israel itu tidak memiliki kemampuan deterrence terhadap Iran dan kaum Israel yang ada di Yaman, kira-kira gitu. Nah, mungkin bisa diskusikan lagi oleh Pak Prabowo, ya, terbuka aja. Ya, soal militer terbuka saja, itu bisa di-research di mana-mana. Dan bagaimana mendevelop sebuah negara besar, itu kira-kira ya kita terdiri negara-negara yang kita remehkan. Kemudian kita tidak hanya satu juga saja. sekian statement saya. Semoga ya Pak Tim, Mr. Tim, thank you very much. Pak Tim ini melakukan banyak riset ya. Kalau teman-teman di Partai Prima itu sosialis, kayaknya banyak harus belajar dari beliau ya, melakukan riset ke negara-negara kira-kira yang di sana, di Amerika, kira-kira Venezuela, Cuba, riset, aktivis, peneliti, riset, dan hidupnya dihibahkan untuk kemanusiaan. Saya kira dia harus dikasih aplaus dan juga punya kesempatan. Dengan macam dia bisa makan dan ya lagi riset itu, lagi riset di Timur Tengah dan mungkin bisa hasilnya bisa dibawa ke sini. Dan juga kita memohon juga ilmuwan-ilmuwan Amerika bisa datang. Thank you very much. Baik, terima kasih mungkin sebagai akhir kata saya mengucapkan terima kasih ya pada undang ke LND pertikaan ini Global Thinkers. Ini merupakan kesempatan yang baik saling tangan dong. Kalau dikasih closing statement, mungkin kembali lagi ya, kita perbanyak hubungan dengan negara-negara lain sehingga kita tidak terjebak dalam hubungan ketergantungan. Ketika kita punya lebih banyak teman, itu kita punya lebih banyak leverage atau daya tawar. Nah, walaupun kondisi geopolitik sekarang banyak yang concern, banyak juga yang mengatakan sebetulnya tidak perlu terlalu khawatir. Karena apa? Karena Amerika Serikat dan Tiongkok itu terjalin dalam sebuah hubungan dagang yang sangat erat. Jadi walaupun secara politik, secara geopolitik itu bisa siku-sikutan, secara mereka pasti akan mempertimbangkan secara ekonomi juga. Kita tanya, mana negara-negara partner perdagangan Amerika yang besar? China salah satunya. Partner dagang Amerika's the US's largest trade partners are Canada, Mexico, then China, then European Union. Big four, and then number five is already much smaller. So China is one of America's largest trade partners. And the same it is for China. Who are China's largest trade partner? Again, the first one, the neighbor, direct neighbor, ASEAN. ASEAN is a direct neighbor to China. China has direct border with Vietnam, with Myanmar, with Laos. ASEAN is China's direct neighbor. So China's largest trade partner is ASEAN, then European Union, then America, the US. And then afterwards, number four is much smaller than three. So there's a big interdependency. And so bagi kita ke depannya untuk menjaga kembali lagi keberdikatian Indonesia. Ya, kita harus punya banyak teman. Dulu kalau bahasa sudah banyak, pasti ya. 1000 teman itu tidak cukup, satu musuh itu kebanyakan. Jadi kembali, kalau kami sudah sangat sepakat, politik bebas aktif, itu harus kita lanjutkan, kita harus balancing negara-negara yang menjadi mitra dagang kita siapa, mitra politik kita siapa, agar kita punya banyak opsi. Kembali, ketika Indonesia punya banyak opsi, itu tandanya kita sudah semakin develop. Kita akan memiliki juga daya tawar yang tinggi. Mudah-mudahan apa yang saya sampaikan selama ini bisa ada manfaatnya walaupun sedikit. Terima kasih juga buat kesempatan yang sudah diundang di sini dan semoga untuk kedepannya kita bisa terus berjejaring dan memperkuat hubungan antara kita dan lembaga. Terima kasih banyak.
Terima kasih banyak, Bang Mun. Sekalian, Bang Mun, penutupnya juga mungkin apresiasinya.
Ya, pertama terima kasih buat Uli dan Bang Ruk, dan teman-teman yang diskusi ini dapat insight yang luar biasa ya, terkait dengan tema kita. Dan saya melihat bahwa diskusi ini belum cukup ya, untuk memenuhi hasrat kita ya, ataupun kehausan kita untuk mengetahui lebih mendalam tentang apa sebenarnya yang terjadi di dunia ini dan seperti apa seharusnya kita persingkat. Ya. Meski demikian, secara umum kita sudah punya sedikit gambaran tentang seperti apa sebenarnya peranan Indonesia dalam bangun global yang sedang berubah ini. Dan saya pikir saya sangat setuju menggarisbawahi tadi yang disampaikan baik oleh Pak Beli bahwa soal kepertikarian, ya, kedaulatan dan tadi kalau tekanan dari yang harus yang lebih ke soal pertahanan, ya, saya lihat itu memang sangat penting tapi mungkin butuh pendalaman lagi tersendiri karena ketergantungan kita ke luar masih sangat besar ya dalam soal pertahanan ini. Dan kalau tidak salah pun masih serpihan ya. Kita hanya beberapa dari Rusia, misalnya Sukhoi yang dibeli zaman Megawati ya, dan juga setelah itu tidak pernah ada lagi apa namanya kerjasama pertahanan dengan negara di luar sebagai Amerika Serikat dengan kemudian yang terakhir kesejahteraan. Tapi mungkin ke depannya yang lebih penting itu adalah bagaimana upayakan sendiri ke industri pertahanan kita, memajukan industri pertahanan kita sendiri. Itu sangat penting. Kemudian yang kedua, saya ingin menggarisbawahi juga soal tadi berkaitan dengan yang pertama, soal kemandirian, keberanikarian secara macam itu adalah soal nasionalisme progresif yang sebagai satu ideologi yang menurut saya menjadi penting karena pertama itu menjadi satu tendensi atau satu kecenderungan yang sedang terjadi di seluruh dunia bagaimana mungkin lebih pola ini dibangun di atas dasar kebangkitan bangsa-bangsa. Kalau mengutip dari seorang expert di luar dari desa itu bilang ini semacam examine sovereignty, jadi menguji kembali kedaulatan, momentum untuk menguji kembali kedaulatan kan sebenarnya apa namanya situasi perubahan demokrasi pola ini. Jadi negara-negara bangsa yang dulu pernah merdeka melawan kolonialisme, kemudian ada proses neokolonialisasi, nah ini sekarang ini momentumnya menguji kembali kedaulatan dari negara bangsa tersebut. Makanya kita di Afrika Selatan, di Afrika, kemudian juga ada kembangan lain di berbagai negara. Ini saya pikir relevan dengan kita yang pertama karena situasi global itu dan kedua di dalam negeri sendiri hampir semua kekuatan politik yang ada di dalam negeri berbicara hal yang sama soal persatuan nasional itu menjadi satu dasar yang sangat strategis. Kalau kita bicara nasionalisme maka persatuan nasional itu juga menjadi syarat mutlak. Tinggal bagaimana kita mendorongnya menjadi progresif. Kalau kepentingan kami yang di sayap kiri ini kan bagaimana mendorongnya menjadi adil ya. Kalau biasanya persatu aja tapi cuma sedikit yang menguasai. Nah kalau di progresif ini bagaimana mendorong supaya bukan cuma persatu tapi adil, ada pemerataannya, ada keadilannya. Itu yang coba kita suarakan. Ya. Mungkin itu. Dua hal yang ingin saya kasih bawahi sebagai posisi jurnal. Sekali lagi, terima kasih teman-teman.
Kalau tadi saya memuji Amerika, saya memuji Amerika. Tanpa Amerika, Uni Soviet yang sekarang menjadi federasi Rusia tidak seperti sekarang. Karena disanksi. Tanpa Amerika, China tidak bisa mengungguli secara ekonomi. Kalau tidak disanksi. Itu bisa mau gak disanksi jadi tidak besar.
Nambah sedikit terima kasih aja ya tentunya di sini, terima kasih juga kepada partner bicara ini Pak Domingus sekjen dari Partai Rakyat Adil Makmur. Ini kita sama-sama partai koalisi ya, koalisi ini kalau sendiri karena kita sentris, ketika sentris dari yang sosialis sedikit ada, dari yang kanan sedikit ada. Jadi kita Indonesia, Indonesia sendiri kan juga sentris ya. Semua kita generasi. Bang Bin Bin yang udah mengundang saya. grup di Institut Global Thinker, semoga ke depan kita bisa terus berkolaborasi. Moderator tentunya tadi disebutkan, tadi dari Berdikari, LMND. Terima kasih untuk undangan. Kembali ke moderator.
Saya tidak punya banyak closing statement lagi. Terima kasih banyak kepada materi dengan segala hormat dan juga rasa penuh. Ya, terima kasih atas apa yang sudah disampaikan, apa yang sudah dituangkan dalam forum yang sederhana tapi luar biasa isiannya. Tapi lagi-lagi ini menjadi apa namanya, sebuah awal yang baik. Semoga ke depan kita masih bisa, ini bagian kulitnya aja kalau kita lihat, ini masih kulitnya, kita belum bicara banyak soal dunia, karena dunia tidak ada Afrika, ada di mana-mana kita bicara soal dunia. Jadi sekian dari saya, mungkin saya akan membacakan kesimpulan sedikit aja. Oke. Intinya adalah bagaimana sama-sama kita diskusikan berdikari, bukan berdikari online tapi berdikari ala Soekarno untuk dijadikan sebagai tonggak kemajuan kita. Terima kasih banyak pemateri dan juga audiens semua yang sudah mempersiapkan ini. Saya moderator Muhammad Armel ngabalin pamit undur diri. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you so much yang ada di